Welcome to our third plenary session on democracy and development. How do they fit together? The revolutions that shook the Arab world 2.5 years ago were centered around demands for dignity, for freedom, for opportunity. And those demands have presented a challenge, I think, both to transitional governments and to actors inside and outside the region seeking to support change, democracy, and reform. Now, when we think about dignity, freedom, and opportunity, it's clear that each of these concepts has both political and economic dimensions. And as societies, transitional governments, international actors have dealt with the post-revolutionary period, it's clear that economic progress and political progress cannot proceed along separate tracks, that in fact they are closely integrated. So our panel is going to dig into this interaction between political development and economic development and what it means. I hope that in the next hour and a half or so, we'll be able to talk about what we've learned from global experiences of democracy and development, how the aspirations and expectations of the public in these countries is shaping strategies in the transition, and how to think about the relative roles and responsibilities of governments in these countries, of civil society, of donor states, international institutions, and the private sector. I'm going to briefly introduce this very distinguished panel that is going to help us explore all of these questions, and then we'll begin our conversation. Immediately to my left, we're delighted to have with us His Excellency Minister Amr Darag, who was appointed a little over a month ago as Minister of Planning and International Cooperation in Egypt. He is also a member of the Higher Commission and the Executive Board of the Freedom and Justice Party, Egypt's ruling party. And if his current duties are not a heavy enough burden, he was last year carrying the burden of being the Secretary General of the Constituent Assembly that drafted Egypt's new constitution. Welcome.
Thank you.
To his left is my friend and former colleague, Nazanin Ash. She is our Deputy Assistant Secretary of State for Near Eastern Affairs in Washington, with responsibility for foreign assistance and partnerships, including MEPI, the Middle East Partnership Initiative, that I know many of you in the audience are aware of and many of you work with. She has a distinguished career in development work inside the U.S. government, in the State Department, and USAID, beginning as a White House fellow, and in the NGO community. Welcome, Nazanin. And then finally, on the other end of the dais is Rabia Ataya, who is the founder and CEO of Bait.com, which is the Middle East's leading job site, sort of monster.com of the Middle East. Is that a good analogy?
Or LinkedIn.com.
Or LinkedIn.com of the Middle East. Rabia is a serial entrepreneur, I think is the term, having founded several successful information technology startups across the Middle East. And so he brings with him not only a private sector perspective, but a perspective that is on the edge of economic dynamism in this region, as in the global economy. Welcome, Rabia. I'd like to begin, if I may, with a question for Minister Darag. You are a politician from Egypt's leading party. Now you're responsible for the ministerial portfolio that manages foreign assistance to Egypt, and in that role sort of coordinates between Egypt's development policy and plans and the outside world. Your party is facing parliamentary elections, we hope within a few months. So I wonder what you can tell us about the expectations of the voters that you anticipate your party will be facing in a few months' time. What are the expectations on which you think the FJP will be judged by voters at the polls with respect to development? And how do you see your role in this period of time before the elections in meeting those expectations?
Thank you, Tamara. I think you started with a very tough question. I thought you'd be, you know, easier on me. But anyway, before I start, let me make an important qualifier. You know, I'm here representing myself right now. Yes, I'm a minister of the Egyptian cabinet, but sometimes I will explain some of the policies the cabinet is pursuing. But nevertheless, the opinions I'm gonna say are really my own opinions. So, for you know, it's very important not to mix this up. And this would make me more comfortable, you know, handling your tough questions.
Please.
What we are going through right now is a very difficult time. And it's a twofold mission for the government or any government, our government or any other government. We need to handle problems, long-term problems, related to bad governance for so many years. And at the same time, we need to deal with the extensive problems related to transition. And both are very tough and very difficult. If you combine them together, it's even tougher. I'm, as an Egyptian citizen, I have a lot of aspirations. I expect a lot from the government, from our leaders, in order to at least put us on the start of the road towards real development and real prosperity and real reform. However, there are a lot of difficulties facing this mission. The first one, in my opinion, is the very high aspirations of people. People would like a lot of things to be done and would like everything to be done now. And we were talking about this yesterday, that you know, it's if it's tomorrow, it will be very late. So everything has to be done right now. People expect their leaders to have different buttons to push this to solve the problem of gas, to push this to solve the problem of electricity, to push that to achieve social justice, and so on and so forth. And if I was not in the government, I would have had the same expectations, definitely. And they are not, I'm not blaming them for that. They have waited for a long time just for this moment, for tens of years for this moment. But this puts a lot of pressure, extensive pressures on any government. You are stuck between you would like to achieve a lot, and you need to do this within a calm environment. You need to concentrate. You need to put plans and execute them with the help of everybody without extensive pressure. So this is one of the difficulties, probably the most difficult one. The other thing is what we term in Egypt and in some other countries as the deep states. The previous regime and the previous systems have left a deeply rooted system of corruption, of bad governance, that is very difficult to give up. Yes, we've had a revolution. Yes, we managed to get rid of a tyrant and his immediate circle, but the bigger circle, the tools that used to be used for implementing all the techniques of corruption and bad governance are still there, everywhere. And unfortunately, it turned out to be much more intense and much deeper than one would have thought. And I'm starting to realize this even more when I'm in government right now. So there is like a big system that is trying to resist everything that you do. Not just that, but it's trying to create crisis every day. You know, we, of course, we have difficulties, but they make things more difficult. Crisis in fuel supply, distribution, crisis in electricity supply, crisis you know, when having gas for your own car, you know, things like that. Sometimes these are problems that are really made. They are not there. Of course, we have problems related to that, but many times there are schemes and plans to make these things even worse. And this is supported by an extensive media coverage that is not, most of the time, really balanced the way they should be. So this is another big difficulty. And the third difficulty is that the world, although everybody over the, you know, everywhere is saying that we are very happy about the Arab Spring, we would like to support the Arab Spring, we would like to give support to new democracies, but yet this is not really translated in terms of actions. Sometimes it is even applied in the form of pressure. Yesterday we were talking about this, and you know, you would hear explanations that this is not really pressure, but it is just helping you to manage in a better way and things like that. But it is really, if you look at many of what we are hearing, it is really pressure.
So can I ask you, as you have taken on this role and have begun to travel to foreign capitals, talk to them about the role that you'd like them to play in supporting Egypt's transition, what is it that you're asking for beyond the patience that you're asking of the public as well?
Okay. The number one, you know, it's not even a word, it's a letters. The IMF, this is the magic word that I hear everywhere. When are you going to have the IMF deal signed? Is it going to be signed at all, or where are you right now? Of course we are quite interested, we are quite keen on having this deal secured as soon as possible. I hope, you know, within weeks. And this is important not because it is the IMF deal, but because what we are doing, what we are planning to do, is really stemming from our real needs to do a lot, to start a lot of reform in terms of handling the budget deficit and so many other things. So this is the first. Everybody in the world seems to be connecting the support to securing the deal. And it seems to be like tied to the moment of signing the deal, rather than coping with the process of reaching the deal. Right now, we are already implementing several steps that could be considered part of this deal, because they are, again, our programs. They are part of our program, and we are implementing. So people are not many times willing to take this into account so that the support can be provided in parallel with the implementation of the reform scheme. This is number one. The second thing that we are always asked about, or we talk about, is what is termed consensus, political consensus. And definitely it would be very nice to have agreement on everything. It would be like, actually we did manage to have that during the 18 days of the revolution. During that time, everybody in Egypt was focusing on one single point. Everybody agreed to that. But unfortunately, this is not the case when it comes to real life. You can always disagree on so many issues. You can never, if you wait in order to move forward, if you wait until everybody agrees on everything, this is really kind of a dream, in my opinion. However, what we should be looking for is a mechanism or providing the platform for what I call managing differences rather than achieving consensus. Because we have to realize that differences are there. That's why we have different political parties. That's why we have democracy. There is a platform that includes the opinion of everybody. But this platform does not mean that everybody should be in the driving seat. This is very important. We have to realize that in any democracy, there is majority, there are elections that result in a parliament, a government, that has a plan and a scheme to implement. There is an opposition that helps. The role of the opposition really helps the government to always correct its path, to do whatever is good for the people. And if the ruling party or the ruling government fails to do that, the people will just get rid of it in the next elections. But to wait until everybody agrees on everything, this is, in my opinion, not realistic at all.
So the term consensus, you're saying, is setting too high a bar.
Maybe
it's a misleading term.
I would say so.
But when we think about a platform for managing differences, mm-hmm. in a consolidated democracy, you have those institutions.
Yes.
Is it part of the challenge in Egypt today that there isn't a full parliament, that those elections haven't taken place yet?
Definitely. This is one of the main problems we're having right now. But I would say that we've moved quite a bit in terms of having democratic institutions in order to be able to finish or get done with the transition period as soon as possible. We do have a president who is democratically elected. We do have a constitution. We do have one of the chambers of the parliament, and we are looking forward to have the other one. We did have it, actually, and it was dissolved. And that, in my opinion, was a big mistake. And we, in at least in our party, our strategy was always to concentrate on having a full set of democratic institutions as a prerequisite for anything. So we have been pushing again for having the elections laws and having the elections done, but due to several reasons they get delayed every now and then. I hope now that hopefully by the end of the year we will have the elections and we have the parliament, so we have the platform that will allow us to manage our differences and move properly on the democratic path. And if we can achieve that in 2 or 2.5 years after the revolution, I think that's okay. I mean, that's not too long, in my opinion.
Thank you. Let me turn now to Rabia, if I may. And I'd like to talk to you a little bit about some of the insights that you can draw from your customer base. You know, we talk a lot in this region about the challenge of employment, especially among young people. And also about the aspiration for self-determination, which of course has a political dimension, but it's also about forging your own path in life. So I'd love to hear a little bit about your customers and what you can tell us about what they're looking for, not just from government, but in their professional lives as well. I'm sorry, I think the microphone's not working. If we can.
A pretty loud voice, so I can project. No? Not that loud?
Do you want to wear mine?
Hello?
There you go.
There we go. Perfect. So I'd like to thank the forum and the organizers for putting this together. As I mentioned to Tamara earlier, I've been very pleasantly surprised by absolutely every part of the experience. And obviously, I'm honored to be amongst such a distinguished panel and audience. When we started BAIT, it's been a 13-year enterprise. One of the big challenges we had in the region was obviously there was a very significant lack of information about what is happening economically in the region, what is happening by way of jobs, and what are youth doing in terms of trying to get control of their destinies. And so very early on, we realized that it was incumbent on us, as we were trying to serve our communities, to try and produce some original research to get some insight into what our populations desire and what they're looking forward to. And one of the very interesting stories has been a story that's given to us or produced as a result of some consumer confidence surveys that we do on a quarterly basis and that we've done since 2007. Now, as we've done those surveys, and they're done in partnership with a leading polling organization called YouGov, we've generally divided the questions into questions that relate to the present tense and questions that relate to the future. So how do people feel about where they are today and where do they project they and their economy will be in the future. Now, what's been interesting is if you track those trend lines, they tend to follow each other in most places almost exactly. So if you look at the UAE, for example, as the personal situations of people have improved, so has their expectation of the future. And as it turned to the negative, for example, in the global financial crisis, people's expectation of the future also turned negatively, almost in an exact parallel line. The same is true in Syria, where after the civil war started, both the current situation as well as expectations of the future, the sentiment turned by over 50% very rapidly. Now, the interesting story may be Egypt's story, where towards the revolution, we saw both people's assessment of their present situation declining, as well as their assessment of what their future held. Then the revolution happened, and what happened there was the trend lines went in wildly opposite directions. So if you look today, Egyptians, since we started the survey, continue to be more optimistic about their future prospects than they ever have, at least, and when I talk about ever, since early 2007. However, when you ask them about their current situation, they continue to find that their current economic situation is deteriorating. And so this comes back to the question of democracy and development. There is an inherent desire for democracy, and there's a realization that democracy eventually leads to development. However, in the present sense, that has not led yet to the development that people have expected. Which brings me to the next question, which is, what do people in the region want? And other than democracy, I've heard in a lot of the working groups and side conversations talk about the youth of the region essentially wanting to be government employees and wanting more government handouts. And our research has shown that couldn't be further from the truth. So we recently conducted research with Stanford University on the topic and found that over 60% of the youth in the region would prefer to be self-employed and would prefer to be part of an entrepreneurial venture. And so they are not sitting there waiting for someone to give them a handout, and they are interested in getting control of their own destiny. However, when asked about their challenges, one of their biggest challenges remains the issue of government regulation and corruption. And the fact that it's not only challenging to start a business, but it's even more challenging to stay in business. And I can, you know, as an entrepreneur in the Middle East who's been doing it for a while now, I can tell you that there isn't a year that passes where we do not face, due to government regulation, an existential challenge to our business, where literally a government official may knock on our door and say, listen, we're gonna shut you down today. To which, you know, the question is always why? We've checked every box, we've followed every government regulation, and so that opacity continues to be a massive challenge. And I'll just cap it off by saying, you know, research globally has shown that employment is primarily driven by SMEs and entrepreneurship. So even in the United States, there was a Kaufman Institute study that showed that the job market would have contracted every year since the 1970s had it not been for companies that are less than 5 years old. So that entrepreneurial segment is essential. And in the Middle East, it's even more essential because that entrepreneurial and SME spirit shows that democracy and representation is alive and well. However, that is the segment that remains the most challenged in the region. And it is incumbent on all of us to press hard to try and facilitate the experience of entrepreneurs setting up businesses and operating them.
So it sounds to me as though what you see in the surveys is a desire not only for political democracy, but for, in a sense, economic democracy, that people want the ability to forge an economic path for themselves, forge a career path for themselves that's not dependent on these bigger structures, but that the policy environment makes a huge difference in their ability to do so.
Without a doubt. And it affects every part of their experience in trying to forge their self-determination. So the fact that the regulatory framework is so difficult doesn't only mean it's difficult to incorporate, it's difficult to raise capital, it's difficult to attract talent, it's difficult to continue to license, it's difficult to, oftentimes it again feels like you're trying to put a circular peg in a square hole type of thing. It is a continuous challenge, and those countries in the region that have striven or strive to bring down the regulatory requirements have been very successful in attracting entrepreneurship. And I always cite the example of Dubai, which has done a phenomenal job of basically making it easy for entrepreneurs from all over the world to come to town, to set up shop, and to operate relatively freely. And I think it's a great example from a regional perspective for the rest of the cities and countries in the region.
So from a private perspective, from a private sector perspective, where if you're trying to raise capital, or if you have capital to invest, what are you looking for in that policy environment? What's most important?
So a few things. One is obviously a structure that you can invest in. So if you look at the corporate structures in the region, they tend to be quite limited and quite complex in nature. In many countries, you are forced to partner with a local. Even if you are a local in many countries, you have a limited form of corporate structures that you can pursue. And so that the fact that as an investor, you don't have an easy structure to invest in or potentially to exit from is in and of itself a challenge. And that's right at the outset. You still have not started to operate. The next challenge is one of transparency with regards to the legal environment. So how can you expect government to react to your normal course of business? And in many parts of the region, I always find it amusing that as you register for a company, you actually have to specify the type of work you're doing, and that's taken from a master list, and oftentimes that master list is 20 years old. And so if you're trying to start an internet business in a certain field, that just doesn't exist. And so you're left to your own devices as to which box do I check? And should you check the wrong box, that opens up the door for someone knocking on your door at some point and saying you're doing something illegal. And so the regulatory framework tends to overregulate and not to create enough freedom of movement, and then in the interpretation tends to be very opaque. And again, that does not help an operator, nor does it help an investor.
So there's an unpredictability in the way government is going to enforce its regulations.
Absolutely.
I want to come back to the issue of the IMF loan that you raised, Minister Darag, because I think it's important to get a handle on what this means. What does an agreement with an international financial institution mean, not only to governments or to donors, but to the private sector as well? But we'll come back to that in a few minutes. Nazanin, I want to ask you, as somebody who's been working on the donor side of this picture for quite a while, how have governments like the United States or others who provide foreign assistance, what lessons have they drawn from their experience about this relationship between policy environment and economic development?
Thank you, Tamara. Thanks for the question. Thanks for hosting all of us. And I add my admiration to my fellow panelists, and it's a privilege to be on this panel with you. And it's an excellent question. I think what we know from the history of the development experience and the donor experience in it is that development progress depends first and foremost on the actions and the choices of political leadership. That donors can play a role, that they can, in the course of their engagement, you look at community responses or donor responses, but there's nothing that donors can do to educate a critical mass, to provide essential security, to create the enabling environment for vibrant entrepreneurship and inclusive economic growth, Those are essentially decisions that need to be taken up by political leadership. And in the absence of those decisions, the kind of assistance donors provide can have limited effect. So the question for us becomes one of how we can play a role in supporting reformers and in mobilizing the political will for reform, and where that comes from. And it's part of why, you know, the U.S. government has been, you know, at the forefront in democracy promotion. I mean, we see the relationship between democracy and development as an essential one, as an essential pathway for influencing precisely the kinds of challenges that you identified, Your Excellency, where you have state institutions and leadership structures that have been held by elites, that are captured by limited segments of the population. And the, you know, the most effective pathway to opening up those systems for the broader good, for the benefit of the broader population, is by bringing them into a political process that allows them to hold their leadership accountable and that allows them to have a voice in the decisions that affect their lives. So as we seek to calibrate the way we play a role in what is essentially a political process, that's increasingly what we're taking on board in decisions we make about how we cooperate, especially in these transitioning environments.
You know, I'm really struck by the way that both of you have talked about this challenge of reform, that it's an intensely political challenge, and that creating wider economic opportunity, development that really affects the whole population and brings everybody up, is something that's contested, it's fought over. A lot of the criticism that one hears of international donors and development agencies is that they take a very technocratic approach to reform. And it sounds to me as though you're saying, Nazanin, that a technocratic approach doesn't work.
That's right. So the challenge for donors is that what we can bring to the table are the technocratic approaches. Right? Because we're blunt instruments. So we can bring financial capital, we can bring technical assistance, we can bring transfers of technology. So, but you know, as you hear from Rabia, as you hear from others who speak to the experience, those are necessary but deeply insufficient. They have to be entered into, and they have to be brought into an enabling environment that's created by the policy and legal and regulatory structures of the state that allow for those inputs, those technical inputs, to really take hold. That doesn't mean that there isn't a role that we can play in, again, mobilizing reform toward that enabling environment. I think that means we have to be much more cognizant about being directly supportive of reformers both in and outside of government. It's part of what you see in some of the new instruments that the U.S. government has proposed, something like the Middle East and North Africa Incentive Fund, where what we're trying to do there is say where governments have put forward credible reform plans to deal with these incredibly difficult issues, to take on the political process in their countries to achieve reform, we want to be able to put support behind that. It's also why we provide support on the demand side, for citizens, for civil society, for the legal frameworks that protect fundamental freedoms of expression and association and assembly, as essential tools in being able to mobilize reformers among constituencies, among citizens, and mobilize those citizen movements that have been so powerful, that we've seen to be so powerful in breaking open what have been these tremendously closed systems and creating the opportunities for broader benefit.
Minister Darragh, Das Ash was just suggesting that when you're facing that resistance from inside the bureaucracy or inside the old elite of the deep state, that those outside in civil society can be an ally. How do you feel about the role that those outside government can play in advancing that reform agenda?
I'll answer that, but I would like to comment on something that Nazanin mentioned. And actually, this is something that I'm finding and I'm realizing during the few weeks that I've been in the office. When it comes to foreign aid or support or whatever, what I'm finding is that in many occasions, there is no compatibility between the real needs of the society, the real needs of our country, and this support is due, okay? And I'm not blaming the donor organization for that, or the country. I'm blaming the state for not defining the real objectives through which these support measures should be channeled. I believe, in many occasions, I'm finding that the only KPI that is being monitored is that whether or not this kind of money was spent or not, whether the project was completed on time or not completed on time. You know, these technical things, technocratic mm-hmm. things that you refer to. But whether the real outcome of this project really shows in terms of an improvement of the overall environment in the country or achieving progress one way or the other, or whether this progress is within the priorities of the countries or not, I'm afraid in many occasions this is really not the case. And I believe that the proper, and which I happen to be in charge of right now, the planning, and it is tied, you realize it's our ministry is planning and international cooperation. Mm-hmm. These are actually two ministries. But it's very important to connect them together, because when you start planning for the country, and you look for the resources that you have within the country, and you look for external support to fill the gaps, you have to have an overall picture that is fitting within the needs of your own country and your own people. Okay, so this is what I have in mind. I would like to start implementing is to apply very strict criteria on the choice of the projects, the choice of the plans that are being financed, either by foreign or local means. You know, it's also not good to locally, in the fact that. There are very limited resources. It is not wise to spend that on things that are not of high priority. So it is very important, and there is a very big room for cooperation between the government and international organizations to work together on defining these priorities and monitoring whether they are really achieving their goal or not. Not just they are being spent or sometimes they are not even being utilized. You know, this is something else. And then that this will bring us to your question, and I believe that the role of the civil society is very important in cooperation with the government in defining these priorities. This is an absolute necessity, because the time is over for the government that is setting all the rules for the society, that is making decisions on behalf of everybody, that is setting the priorities without discussion with everybody. Of course, somebody will come and say, but this is not happening, you know, the way it should be. And then, of course, it's still not happening, because we need time in order to be able to do that. There's a lot of things to be done in order to put us on the right track to be able to implement this. But in principle, we have to realize that this is very important, to have a very good and lively civil society that will help direct the government towards the proper priorities, the proper planning, and proper implementation. That's why we have plans also within the planning function of the government to involve the public in the planning process. We are planning a couple of ambitious projects for several things. For example, to have our public projects, our intended public projects, and our running public projects put on the web very transparently, so that they can be monitored, they can be discussed, suggestions can be made by anybody. And the other thing is to simplify the planning process in the eye of the citizen, in order to allow the citizen to contribute, to make a positive contribution in the planning function. And this can be done through extensive a process of extensive discussion within the society. In order to be able to do that, you have to have, of course, a strong civil society. This is a necessity. But again, we need to realize that we need to have time in order to allow this process to be activated in the proper way.
You know, we've been talking a lot about the long-term horizon mm-hmm. on development and the kinds of performance indicators that it sounds like you think are more appropriate are things where you would only see impact over a longer time horizon. But the part of the challenge that all of you have cited is rising expectations and short-term stabilization. So how can we bridge the gap between transitional governments that are urgently seeking solutions to stabilize their economies and to keep their political transitions on path, but have a challenge in getting those decisions made and in a way that can stick, and donors who understand this is a very sensitive environment, and so they can't come in a heavy-handed way, and yet the local government may not be ready to put forward a full slate of plans and priorities. So how do we bridge that gap? Nazanin, do you have any thoughts?
So I think it's an incredible challenge. You've identified, you know, one of the most difficult ones. And I think, you know, reflecting on the way the U.S. has been engaged in these, you know, we sought early on to be a partner in fiscal stabilization. In many cases, we sought to do that in conjunction with international partners. As a means to, you know, making our limited assistance go further in helping to address and supporting the implementation of necessary fiscal stability reforms. And then in the medium term, really sought to focus on many of these aspects of job creation, support to entrepreneurship, SME growth that Rabia mentioned, you're recognizing the same thing that my fellow panelists have recognized and that so many have recognized from the region, that this is an essential, it's an essential mode of addressing demands for economic opportunity.
So I'm sorry, can I just go back to the short term sure. for a sec? So when you're engaged in that multilateral dialogue with other donors,
right.
is there a sort of bottom line consensus amongst you on what those key steps are that the transitional governments have to take to stabilize their economies?
So I think, importantly, it's not a consensus among just international donors. I think there's broad consensus on the challenges in the macroeconomic environment. There's broad consensus on those challenges, and there's broad consensus on what needs to happen. And that's not just among international donors. I think that's also with respect to our, you know, the governments with whom we partner. What's more difficult is consensus around the implementation of those conclusions. When, what, how, on what time frame? You know, there's much less consensus. And I think, you know, and that remains, you know, part of the dialogue. And, you know, you saw sort of very rapid fiscal stability support in the Tunisian context, for example, and they've just signed their IMF agreement. In the Egyptian context, it's been more difficult as the government has grappled with questions of what and when and how. Can I add one other part of the short term? I mean, so in the macro environment, you know, sort of the fiscal stability concerns, but the other thing that I think we've really sought to focus on in the short term are building those institutional foundations that we think are going to be essential over the immediate, medium, and long term to making some of these important decisions. And that's where you've seen, you know, support to civil society, support to new political processes, support to, you know, emerging free media. I mean, that's another place where we've made significant investments in the transitions in the immediate term, because we see the important role they'll play, you know, over the course of an unfolding political process.
And Rabia, from a private sector perspective, is this, you know, this question of fiscal stability and the kinds of reforms that are linked to, for example, an IMF deal, how meaningful is that? What kind of signal does that send to the private sector and to capital markets?
When you look at, I think, an economy, the various players in it, you have the large publicly listed organizations that get a lot of international investment where that is allowed. And certainly to show that type of deal being done and that type of stability is extremely important for the international investor. I would say your average person on the street is far more concerned about his breadwinning today and about what type of things are making his or her life easy or difficult in the very present term. And I believe there are lots of quick wins that can be done for that person on the street that leverage a lot of the technologies that exist today that make their life significantly different, whether or not from a global perspective the investment environment has improved. So again, we go back to the story of corruption in the region, which seems to be in a lot of places pervasive in absolutely every one of life's major transactions. So your average person, whether or not they're trying to get a phone line, a passport, documentation, certification, incorporate a company, in each and every one of these steps, they may be facing a corrupt official on the other side, and they may realize that that transaction could not occur unless they pay homage to the person standing behind the table. And so when I look at the problem, there is certainly the macro that has to be dealt with, and stabilizing the fiscal status of the country. But I also feel that on a grassroots perspective, there's a lot that can be done. And you know, we had this conversation just before this panel. I think technology can be significantly leveraged to resolve a lot of these things. The concept of e-government, the ability to actually do a lot of transactions without having to go stand in line, without having to meet a bureaucrat, without having to pay homage, would facilitate and expedite a lot of transactions and would make your average person on the street feel like something has fundamentally changed. And obviously those technologies help with transparency, they help in terms of an audit trail, and they have an automatic sense of something's happened. It's a quick win. And as I said earlier, I don't believe those should be immediate replacements to the existing systems, but they can run in parallel. And then it is left up to the consumer whether or not they want to pursue the electronic system or whether they would like to stand in line and process one of their transactions. And so, you know, I look at the IMF deal and I think that is very significant, but I also feel that on a day-by-day basis, the governments in the region can do a lot to make their citizens and their residents feel like they are in control of their destiny and that they do not have to be a part of the corrupt system. And I think those deals do not have to fight the deep government and should be done and can be done immediately.
Minister Darragh, you talked earlier about the work that's already underway in terms of tax reform, in terms of subsidy reform, to deal with some of the structural and macroeconomic challenges. How would you respond to Rabia's point about quick wins? Where's the balance for you between the quick win and the deep institutional reform?
This is one of the challenges, of course, and I totally agree with Rabia on the point he was making, and we were having a discussion before this panel about this. In Egypt, for example, in Egypt, we are not lacking the technology or the ability to implement a system like this. As a matter of fact, I'm finding that there are already systems that have been designed, that have been installed, that are there just waiting for somebody to push the button. And nobody was pushing that button. And it was a real political decision. You know, the idea of, you know, hiding things, the idea of, you know, in order to be able to go ahead and utilize the means of corruption, this is something that will definitely hurt you if you want to do that. So there was a strong, and there still is, a political will, you know, within the governmental agencies and bodies not to go ahead with something like this. So this is important. But we do have the intention to move as fast as possible in this direction. We are already implementing this in, for example, public tenders. This is all now provided online, and everybody has the access and can know, you know, what to do and how to put the bids. Fiscal information and the balance sheets of all public companies are also now posted on the web so that they can be looked at and problems can be identified. But on another context, I would like to point out that the fiscal reform and the deal with the IMF is not really the reform, the whole reform. This is step one of the reform. It's very important to realize that, because some people, when they talk about this, when we have an IMF deal or we achieve the objective of reducing the budget deficit, that's it, we made it. Unfortunately, this is not the case. So we are pursuing a plan, and this is very soon going to be available to the public to start discussing, so that we can have the proper support to implementing it. It's like maybe 6 or 7 steps to pursue reform. Number one is the fiscal reform. Afterwards, there are necessities that have to be dealt with. Number two, after the fiscal reform, is fighting corruption. This is absolutely important, and the mechanisms to do that have to be well defined. It is, we've been discussing this morning, and it is really like a cultural problem rather than a technical problem. Sometimes it's even hard to define corruption. When you ask employees, they think that what they are doing is part of their job. It's not a corrupt behavior or anything like that. So this is something that has to be dealt with in the long term. If you decide to start to attack corruption once and for all, you'll end up with having nobody working in the government, and you will sacrifice a lot of experiences that are there and that are needed for the reform process. So this has, the process of handling this has to be very well designed to achieve the balance between fighting corruption and maintaining the functions of the government. And you need also definitely a legal framework through a parliament that has to work on a lot of legislations in terms of, for example, money laundering, in terms of protecting witnesses for cases related to corruption, in terms of transparency, freedom of access to information. All this kind of legislation is very important to be put in place in order to help fighting corruption. Number three, and this is not in series, it's in parallel, is to facilitate employment and push for the inclusiveness of as much of the society as possible, particularly young people. And the best way to do this is through SMEs. That's why it's one of the main priorities when we discuss with our partners of development, is how to really help us implement this. The problems are not just, sometimes we talk about entrepreneurs, you know, a la Dubai model, you know, which is, you know, starting lavish businesses and stuff like that. But we're talking about very small investments that will help somebody to have his own work, maybe employ a couple of people to be able to move forward. So how to get financing, how to manage the risk related to this type of financing, how to build the capacity of those people in order to be able to do what they need to be doing without having previous experience in this, how to market the products of these SMEs, how to integrate these products within a larger context of an industrial development, how to direct the development in SMEs, not just to help the people managing their own lives, but to help also development plans, a larger development plans in terms of industrial development. And so this is absolutely important, the work on SMEs and empowerment and exclusive and inclusiveness of the society. Then we can start talking about attracting investments, whether local or foreign investments, paving or providing the environment, the proper environment to be able to do that through legislation, through procedures, so many things. And hand in hand, we work on also putting on the table a lot of mega projects. And this is what we're working on right now in the planning stage. Mega projects that will help us take the area of the country that we are living on from 6 or 7% to maybe 30 or 35% of the area of our country within 20 or 25 years. We talk about the Suez Canal Corridor project. We talk about extensive industrial developments based on mining, a lot of development in infrastructure, renewable energy. You know, all these are large projects, and we intend to empower the private investments into these mega projects quite extensively, because the means that the government has is are limited. I mean, for that. So definitely, the last thing is to which also is helps achieving quick win, for the case of Egypt and probably Tunisia as well, is tourism. Tourism is a very important tool. We have the ingredients, we have the infrastructure, we have qualified people, and all what we need is a lot of tourists to come and help our economy. And also, we help them enjoy themselves to have good vacations. So this is very important to work on, you know, to achieve quick wins, I think, in the short term as well.
So you just laid out six components of a development agenda: fiscal reform, mm-hmm. anti-corruption, empowering SMEs in the private sector, improving the investment environment, investing in mega projects, and building back tourism.
That's right.
So you now have a six-point plan for Egyptian development, and donor and IFE audience, please take note. Nazanin, you wanted to make a point earlier, I didn't get back to you.
Yeah, so a couple quick ones. To the question that you posed to Rabia on the significance of the macro structuring and the related IMF support, and why this has been such a huge issue in the donor community, I 100% affirm what you said about the need for the quick wins and for changes in the space that immediately impact the lives of populations that have been disenfranchised. It's also a huge part of why the donor community has been so active on the fiscal stability issues and the macro restructurings. You know, in so many of these countries, you know, those subsidy systems have been instruments of patronage themselves, and have been a real factor in taking resources out of the economy that's available to development that benefits the broad base of the population. So part of the reason, there's a real opportunity in this moment, in the real moment of fiscal stability crisis, to address that and also to communicate that for what it is, as consistent with the platforms on which new leadership has emerged for greater equity and for greater justice and for greater economic and political opportunity. Speaking from the perspective of the United States, again, I go back to why we care. It's not because it's not a decision that's isolated from a desire to see more of the resources in country going to more of the population in a more equitable distribution, and not through patronage systems that benefit elites. And that's the restructuring opportunity that's available when you look at things like subsidy reform that are being required by so many of the macro restructuring programs. On the SME front, and to a point that you've made, Your Excellency, on donor priorities, it's a place where it perfectly illustrates a point I made at the outset of the conversation, where donors can do good in this environment, right? So We've provided a lot of entrepreneurship mentoring. We've set up enterprise funds in Egypt and Tunisia to provide financing to entrepreneurs. We're doing a lot of education for employment type programs and various other programs that have made financing or technical assistance and mentoring available to emerging entrepreneurs. What we find, though, is that the impact of those initiatives are tremendously limited. Again, we can't get to the scale that's necessary when we immediately run up against the policy, legal, and regulatory restrictions compounded by corrupt institutional practices that get in the way of growth. It's the huge contributor to the fact that that so much is happening in the informal sector. It's a huge contributor to the fact that employers have such a hard time growing their businesses and taking on new employees. So we make those investments in the space where we can, but we could be so much more impactful as a partner if those other more difficult issues were taken on. Which is my last point, which is that there's a real privilege in sequencing that I fear that current leadership doesn't have. These issues are all interrelated: corruption, subsidy reform, SME, regulatory environment reforms. I mean, these are all very related. We're eager to find a way to partner on a more aggressive agenda that addresses them on a more aggressive time frame.
So you're saying the challenge of political will that you mentioned, Minister Darragh, is compounded by the fact that all these things have to be done at once. I'm also struck, though, putting together what I've heard from each of you about the relative role of government versus private sector in generating economic opportunity. It's almost as though there's a sense in government, and particularly in those who have been working in government for a long time, that the state should be the driver. But Rabia, you seem to be saying that on the part of the public and young job seekers, expectations have already been set. They're not looking to the state to make opportunities. They want to make those opportunities themselves. So perhaps those in government who fear a public backlash, if they were to step back from that driver's seat role in economic development, you're suggesting that public backlash isn't necessarily there.
I certainly don't believe it is, nor has my experience shown that it would be. I think the public has come to the realization that over the years, if government continues to drive economic growth, the benefactors tend to be a very slim segment of the society who get very, very wealthy while the rest of the society doesn't. And so there's a fundamental understanding that government continuing to drive growth will perpetuate the systems that people have already rebelled against. And I think just going back to a point His Excellency made about, you know, the training and the experience for entrepreneurs and SMEs, and that's certainly welcome, but I generally find that if you look all over the world, entrepreneurs aren't trained to be entrepreneurs. Entrepreneurs, for the most part, are, you know, some of the most successful in the world. There are college dropouts who are willing to take risks. And there's a regulatory environment and there's a risk-taking framework that supports them in doing that. So whether it's a Steve Jobs or a Larry Ellison or a Bill Gates, at age 19 or 20 dropping out and deciding to pursue that path, I don't know that they were trained to be entrepreneurs. Now, that's not to say training isn't important and mentorship isn't important, but the first and foremost step is about creating the regulatory framework that allows people to take risks, that allows people to bet on those taking risks or an investor to pursue them, and then that once that bet pays off, to either make a lot of money, or if that bet doesn't pay off, to walk away and try your next bet. And that whole framework does not exist right now. And that's the fundamental first step. Everything else to me is secondary. And this speaks to the point that Nazanin made, that you know, we will always be limited in our scope to help SME growth if we're not focusing first and foremost on the regulatory framework.
On the regulatory framework. I want to get to questions from the audience, but I see that each of you wants to make a brief point, so if you could briefly.
A couple of points. I'm not saying that we need to train people to be entrepreneurs. There are a lot of people who have the will to be entrepreneurs, but they simply do not have the tools to be successful. This is the point. So they, unfortunately, they fail. They don't have the ability to have a reasonable feasibility study. They don't have the basic knowledge of how to manage their finances. They don't have even the markets to market their products. So these are the areas that require training and they require support. But I cannot just train somebody to convince him to become an entrepreneur. This is something that is built in his or her nature that allow them to. So this is very important. And the other very important point is related to the role of the states. I would like to clarify that. When I refer to planning, I'm not saying that the state should be the driver of the economy or the main to the country. What I'm saying is that the state has to play the role of the state in providing the regulatory platform, in providing the overall, if you will, scheme of development in the country, that people know that development in these directions would lead to very good results. In our planning budget for investment, for example, we are allowing investments of at least 2/3 to be coming from the private sector. So it is not led by the public sector. But it is very important also for the government, and that has been proven through recent experiences when the governments do not really play the role that they should be playing. When you leave everything to the markets, you know, you start to get a lot of problems, and this has been proven quite significantly during the last few years. So there should be a balance between the role of the state as providing the political regularity and the planning platform, and then leave the initiative to the private sector and to the civil society in order to lead the development process themselves.
Thank you. Nazanin.
Yeah, I wanted to go back to your framing of a state-led process and sort of the way in which both of my fellow panelists have commented on that. And I'd emphasize that while there's a distinct role for the state to lead, appropriately what they're leading is a process that brings, you know, their citizens and their private sectors and their civil society organizations robustly into the decision-making frame. I mean, think about how much better any discussion around changes in the regulatory environment and the policy environment would be if Rubio was at the table and could speak from his personal and his aggregated experience as an entrepreneur and as a leader of entrepreneurs, right? Or think about, you know, the failures of any models of 10 smart economists in a room trying to make decisions about to address the diversity of needs and the nimble solutions required to respond to, you know, a population of 90 million. And the greater problem is that in so many of these countries, it's not 10 smart economists in the room, it's 10, you know, it's a closed political process of, you know, a small number of political leaders with their own patronage and constituencies. And it's political bargaining in a closed door system without the pressures of the population to be able to force broader responsiveness. And you know, when Your Excellency talks about, you know, the pressure of the press and the pressure from the street, you know, I think you know, one way to look at that is as, you know, as the opportunity, as, you know, to free your press, you know, open your books, open your decision-making processes, be more transparent, bring citizens into the, you know, give them the tools they need to be able to be a productive participant, and allow citizens to organize and associate and mobilize to help contribute to the prioritization process and to the solution set that'll be most responsive to what they need and when they need it.
Thank you. Well, we've put a lot on the table, and I can see some hands up already, so I'm gonna ask our staff members with the microphones. We'll start here in the front with Imam Magid.
The question I have, the role of the army.
The role of the army.
Army, military, in the those emerging democracy. That is, in some countries, the army controls so much of the investment. How do you break from that? The second question I have is something called inside trading in America, where somebody, you know, sell their stocks before everyone else. In the third world countries, they have inside information. The political parties, they control the government, get inside information, pass it to their business people to say, we need sugar. And therefore, you see the people who are doing the business are from the political party ruling, but they are not saying that we're giving them the contract, but they tell them when to cut the contract. How do you address those issues?
Okay, so a question about the role of the military in the economy, and also we've been talking a lot about petty corruption, but I think this is a question about crony capitalism and high-level corruption. Who would like to start?
I'm assuming that that question was directed to me.
I think so.
I'll volunteer to answer. Okay. I'll be very frank. In countries where the military have had a significant role in the states, in the political life, and economical life, for years and years and years, it's very important to realize that you cannot achieve a safe transition suddenly. You have to allow some time for a safe transition to take place. And this is what I believe we are doing right now in Egypt. And we are doing this through a gradual process. First, we started, actually, I give the credit to the president, President Morsi, started by abruptly putting an end of the interference of the military into the political life. That what took place last year, it was very, very decisive, and it was very well perceived all over the country. And as a matter of fact, even by the military, because the military realized that by getting too much involved into politics, it affected their credibility and their status in the society very much. So this is a very important step that was made. When it comes to the economy, it's very difficult to try to plan to get the military out of the economic activities. In a country like Egypt, some estimate that the military contribute to more than 30% of the economy. And you cannot, I'm not sure whether this is true or not, but some say it's less, some say it's more. But nevertheless, it's a significant part of the economy. And the amount of involvement is not the important issue. The important issue is how transparent this involvement is. Right now, we are, according to our constitution, our new constitution, all companies owned by the military that are involved in civilian activities are going to be monitored the same way as any other public company. The budgets are open, audited, everything is quite transparent. So this is very important. The other thing, when it comes to the controlling the military budget, this is another, maybe you did not ask about this, but this is to complete the picture. It is not right now, according also to our constitution, is not just up to the military to decide on this. This is a joint decision between the military and the civilian within the context of what we term the National Defense Council, that is formed half civilian, half military, chaired by the president, who's civilian. So there is a very careful tool and mechanism to look into the issues of not just the budget, but also how fit the army is to do its function, to manage its responsibilities. So it's very, very important to handle this issue quite carefully, quite gradually, in order to achieve a safe transition. And this has been the experience of all other countries that went through the same experience before. When it comes to the other issue of transparency and the privilege that some businessmen have the information, that's why they can achieve benefit. The only way to do this is to try to implement transparent processes as much as possible. And as I said, right now, all public tenders, the moment they are announced, they are put on the web, so they are known. And the tendering process is quite transparent. But more importantly, when we talk about planning, about setting the priorities, we intend to have a significant role of the public within this planning process. So nothing comes suddenly. You know, everybody, right now, for example, we talk about the development of the Suez Canal corridor or the large industrial development based on mining. All this is still, I mean, the master plan did not even start yet, but still we are announcing our plans and we are involving the public into discussions. So this is the way to achieve as much involvement of the public and the civil society as possible in the planning and implementation phases in order to limit the opportunity for anybody who would like to make use of any corruption schemes, as you mentioned.
Would either of you like to add anything? Okay, we have a lot of questions already, so I'm gonna take maybe two or three from the floor and then come back to the panel for answers. And I'm gonna ask each of you please to try and be as brief and concise as possible and restrict yourself to one question. Let's start over here on all the way on the right. Yep.
Thank you very much. I'm Josh Rogan with Newsweek. You discussed briefly the role of civil society in Egypt, our distinguished guest from Egypt. I'm wondering if you could talk about the effect of the recent sentencing of 43 NGO workers and 16 Americans on the U.S. Egypt bilateral relationship. As you know, Congress is threatening to restrict aid based on these prosecutions. It has also hurt the reputation of Egypt amongst investors and tourists. And I'm wondering, does the Egyptian government have a plan to get out of this dispute, to move forward from this crisis so that the bilateral relationship can continue and make progress? Thank you.
Thank you. And if you could just pass the microphone two seats down to the gentleman there.
Zakaria Matar, National Conscious Front of Egypt. I'm speaking to His Excellency Omar Darraj.
You're in the hot
Excellency,
seat today.
You know that in the last 50 years, we were adopting the foreign strategies for development, and it's failed. When we deposed Hosni Mubarak, I have a burden of debts, 20,000 Egyptian pounds, 60% of Egyptians under poverty line. And I mean, you know, the other indicators are depressive and provocative. So I am telling you that no one will build our country. You know that America in a crisis, $16 trillion debt, and also Europe. So if our people not build our country, no one will build it. You didn't speak about stability. There is a faction of Egyptian who is called, whose opposition is derailing the development by making instability in Egypt deliberately. That is one, you have to mention it. Also, the performance of the government is not inefficient, so you have to speak about this. So I leave. I mean, it is okay. Enough. These
right,
3 points.
Okay, so more of a couple of comments than questions, but we'll see if anyone wants to address those. And then let's go over to this side. Is it Wajiha?
Thank you very much. Well, I want to comment about the democracy and the development.
Sorry, would you just introduce yourself?
Yes. My name is Wajiha Al-Baharna from Bahrain. I want to comment about your question about how the democracy and the development, they could fit together. Now, the quick answer to this is that they fit together very well. But it depends on what we mean by democracy. Do we mean just the electoral system and the segregation of authorities, etc., or we mean no democracy plus the values of democracy? Because we, as we have seen, is that development would be very endangered, affected if the coming parties or group to the government, it will be affected by the type and the point of view of that government. So what we need is that to have more also focus on just ruling not only by democracy as a rigid system, but also as values, which means the respecting the diversity, tolerance, etc., etc. And this is what should be on our daily life. Now my question is that how can we overcome these deficiencies or negative points about reaching the government only by election and according to the concept of majority? So if the majority is not representing accurate thing or the way of governance or good governance, then the whole the people of the country, they will be affected. And also because the one who reached by according to majority concept, he will serve only his parties or his people. So my question is that we used to say democracy is the solution and is the only solution because it depends on the majority. Now what are the other ways of systems that which has not the same deficiency that's in democracy? Thank you.
Okay, thank you. So that we've got three important sets of issues on the table, but why don't we start with Wajiha's point about democracy? If we mean in terms of broadening the benefits to all the citizens, then we can't just talk about majority rule. Right? So how do we go beyond that concept of majority rule?
Sure. And your original point, Wajiha, too, is that it can't just be about the ballot box, right? Which is, which I agree is necessary but insufficient. And it's why you need the rest of the values and the institutional underpinnings of an effective democracy, including inclusiveness, including minority protections and rights. Including open press and as I've talked about over and over again, freedoms of expression and association and assembly that allow collective voices to be heard and allow concerns to be aggregated and elevated and mobilized in a way that can influence processes, not only in the context of elections, but in the context of the constant set of decisions and planning processes that are underway in which citizen voices need to be represented.
So there was also a point made that Europe and the West are having their own economic troubles. And they're not, even if they were interested, they're not necessarily capable of providing the kind of support that these Arab post-revolutionary countries need right now. Nazanin, from a donor perspective, do you want to take that on?
Yeah, I mean, I think that is, I mean, that's a fact that that we're operating in highly constrained environments, and it places even higher burdens on donor governments to ensure that the assistance that we're providing and the way in which we're partnering achieves outcomes that matter to the populations that we seek to assist and to the objectives that we share with our partner governments for broader, more inclusive, more sustainable development that leads to greater stability and prosperity for all.
Go ahead.
Well, maybe also to answer this question, it is what we are talking about is not really in terms of what the donors provide and the foreign aid. What we are really looking for and talking about is investment, is tourism, partnerships and things like that. And what I know is that in spite of the financial difficulties that Europe and many parts of the world are facing, they do not lack, investors do not lack cash for investments. This is something else, okay? And what they need to have is an environment that is safe enough and stable enough for them to make profit and for that profit to be very good. In a country like Egypt, we do have a great potential for making a lot of development and hence a lot of profit for investors. And what we are working on is to, right now, is to complete the environment that is needed by the investors to come and invest in our countries. So this is very important. It's not we will not be waiting for financial aid and financial support forever. This is something that is very temporary. We believe that our country has a lot of potential, have a lot of resources, just waiting to be developed. Okay, so this is very important to point out. I'll go now to the question of the NGOs and this, which is obviously an important question. Let me start by stating that in our policy, at least as a party and also as a government, civil society is one of the three main pillars that we depend on when it comes to development. The three pillars are the state, the private sector, and the civil society. So this is intrinsic in our concept for development. It's very important. Our work has always been as a civil society organization. I mean, you know, regarding my background and the background of our party, we've been probably one of the most active NGOs for tens of years. So we know exactly what it means to be an active NGO and what the NGOs and what the civil society can achieve for the society. So this is very important to realize. The second thing is that the problem that we are having right now didn't start now and is not really made by the current government or by the current regime. And this, as because I've been reading a lot of statements and notions as if this is a problem of the current regime that was created by the current regime. That was a problem that started even before the revolution, it continued a little bit afterwards. Then it went through a legal process, and what we got finally is a legal verdict that has to be dealt with in this context. Some people would argue that this is not it is politically oriented one way or the other. I cannot comment on that. I cannot get into the intentions of the judges, but this has to be contested in the legal context. If we are looking for a state of the law, if we are looking for a state that implements legal processes, we have to follow this. But let me assure everybody that Egypt is a country that encourages civil society. Right now in Egypt, we have 35,000 NGOs working, out of which maybe more than, I would say, 100 foreign NGOs are on the ground. Last year, about 4,500 new organizations were registered. Okay, the average used to be like 800 or 900 before the revolution. So the direction is for the empowerment of the civil society. Of course, there are problems related to these three or four organizations, but it's not a problem for everybody. But it has to be dealt with, definitely, and this has to be done through the legal process that is appropriate in this context. We are working now, as you know, on the new NGO law. This has developed quite significantly over the course of time. The presidency actually has undertaken the mission of collecting input from a lot of resources and issued another draft that is available right now. It was sent to the Shura Council for discussion. Then it will be subject to more discussion in the Shura Council and more public interaction in order to even improve it further. There is a significant, if you compare this version, I'm not saying this is the most perfect law that you can ever have, but if you compare this to what we used to have before, and you think of the extreme difficulties that civil society used to face, and you compare that to what we are having right now as a draft, okay, you'll find a significant improvement. And I hope that through discussions, we will have this improved more for better empowerment of the civil society, which is absolutely important for the development of our country.
Thank you. Nazanin?
Yes, definitely want the opportunity to respond. And we've had many discussions about this over the course of yesterday, which I appreciate. You know, Josh's question was about the chilling effect of this on civil society in general, you know, on the effect on civil society and the effect on the bilateral relationship. You know, we are obviously extremely concerned about the outcome of the verdict and the trial. We've said from the start that we felt like it was politically motivated. That taken together with actions on the NGO law, again, like we see having an incredibly chilling effect on civil society activity, on their ability to partner with international organizations and share best practices and be productive partners in the development and the political and economic development process that's underway in Egypt. And I affirm, Your Excellency, that this was, you know, with respect to the trial itself, it was a process that began with the previous government. But I think the opportunity at hand with the clemency authorities of the president is to not just to, you know, not just to reverse the outcomes of the trial because it's important to the bilateral relationship, but it is. Extremely, but also to do it as an affirmation of the platform that captured the faith of so many Egyptians, and that brought this government to power, that it would be a government ensuring greater freedom and greater equity and greater justice, and to affirm, you know, the very positive statements you've made about the role civil society needs to have. And importantly, the way they need to be able to partner among themselves and with international organizations to play their productive role.
Thank you. Rabia, anything you want to add?
No, I think I'll pass.
Okay. All right. I'm going to take the next set of three, and we'll start in the front row here in blue. Sep Merangiz, do I recognize you? Sorry, guys, the lights are really hard in here, but I am taking note of your hands. Go ahead, please.
Thank you very much. My name is Mehrangiz Kar. I am Iranian lawyer. And I do have a question on the issue of Egypt and tourism, because I had been in Egypt 2011. And I could understand that the major problem for the people, ordinary people, was, you know, something that happened for having tourists in Egypt after something happened before victory of Ikhwan al-Muslimin. Now, this question, I guess, is getting more serious because according to the constitution, new constitution of the Egypt and during that Ikhwan al-Muslimin established the government, how you can plan for attracting tourists again to Egypt, because in Iran we do have a constitution. It's not very similar with your constitution, but it's full of obstacles for, you know, attracting tourists in Iran. And this is my question, and I would be appreciate if you help me on that. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. We're going to try and get to as many questions as possible in the 10 minutes we have remaining. I apologize in advance. There's no way we're going to be able to get to all of you. So I'm going to go in the order that I saw you raise your hands, and that would take us to the lady in the white jacket in the center. If you can get a microphone there, please. Cynthia.
Hi, Tammy. Thank you. Just quickly to come back to the NGO issue in Egypt, Mr. Minister, if you wouldn't mind just addressing again the question of the NGO law, which you suggested was actually freer than previous laws, which I don't believe is actually the case. And I think instead, in the words of the Deputy Assistant Secretary, it will have a chilling effect. And you also mentioned that the trial, you know, it's a legal verdict, what can I do? And people can appeal, but in fact, you know, one of your citizens, Nancy O'Kale, seeking political refugee asylum in the United States, can only repeal her 5-year sentence for the crime of directing Freedom House in Cairo by, in fact, going back to Egypt and going to jail, which seems kind of brutal. But your moderator is actually the expert on this.
Okay. Cynthia, thank you. And the gentleman with the mustache in the second row.
Shukran. أنا رضا شكونديلي أستاذ تعليم عالي بالجامعة التونسية في الاقتصاد.
I'm sorry, just give us 1 minute to get these on.
أريد أن أطرح مشكل نحن في تونس تعاقدنا مع صندوق النقد الدولي بمبلغ ما قيمته 1.75 مليار دولار. المشكل ليس في هذا التعاقد ولكن المشكل في صعوبة تطبيق الإصلاحات. سوف أخذ مثالين. المثال الأول هو مشكلة الدعم. الكل فرح بهذه الثورة والكل يريد أن يحسن أوضاعه الاجتماعية في هذه الثورة. لما نزيد الدعم سوف يرتفع الأسعار ولما ترتفع الأسعار سوف تطالب وبدأ يطالب اتحاد العمال بالزيادة في الأجور. أرد إذا كان الهدف من إزالة الدعم هو التخفيف من العبء على ميزانية الدولة فسوف ترتفع الدعم العبء على الميزانية لما يرتفع ترتفع الأجور. هذا من ناحية. من ناحية أخرى الموضوع الثاني الإصلاحات الثانية هي تخص التخفيض في قيمة العملة التونسية. نحن لنا ذكرى سيئة وسيئة جدا في تونس لما خفضنا في سنة 1986 قيمة الدينار التونسي ب 15% وكانت تنافسية المؤسسة ربحناها ب التنقيص في السعر وليس بالزيادة في الإنتاجية، يعني تنافسية وهمية وليست تنافسية حقيقية. لما نخفض في القيمة السعر الواردات سوف يرتفع وخاصة على مستوى البترول المحروقات، وهذا ما سيزيد في دعم الدولة وسوف يثقل ميزانية الدولة. يعني الإجراءات نريد منها تخفيف ما في عبء الدولة سوف تزيد في هذا العبء. وشكرا.
Thank you. Okay. I think we're going to have to stop there just for time reasons in order to give our panel a chance to respond. So actually, Rabia, if I can begin with you because this last question raised the challenge that some of the steps that governments need to take put an immediate burden on the most vulnerable in society. And you know, there's obviously a role that the IMF and other donors can play in trying to ameliorate that effect, but official donors and government money can't do it all. So how do we help to ease the path between the short-term pain and the long-term gain?
I wish I knew the answer to that question, but I'll give it my best try. And I think ultimately the question is, as you're removing all of these subsidies and all of this assistance, is how much of it is going back to the people and is that measurable? Can people actually see that is trickling to another place in a non-corrupt fashion that is inclusive? And ultimately, that's a difficult challenge, and I'm not sure how to bridge that challenge from a policy perspective. But certainly, if you remove the subsidies on fuel, everyone in the society feels that instantaneously. And so can you make them feel the positive effect of that also instantaneously? And I think across the region where I've seen it happen, the positive aspect has not been felt, only the negative aspect, and that's why we've seen riots in various places where this has happened. So, you know, it's an important question and one that ultimately I don't know the specific answer to, though I do know that both the receiving government as well as the governments that are imposing this or requesting this should think deeply about how to affect the man on the street positively through the change.
And a huge piece of that.
If I may, I think there was one other element of this question that might be worth raising, which is the role of labor unions. Because part of the pressure against these macroeconomic reforms comes from labor unions who are aggregating the interests of their workers, demanding salary increases, demanding that some of these steps be rolled back. When you talked earlier about the regulatory environment that enables business, for a lot of businesses, that means fewer unions or unions that are less powerful. How do we address that challenge?
From my perspective, generally, if you look at the region, and I sort of have a pretty decent regional view, but not necessarily a micro view into every country, and if you look across the region, labor unions have not historically had a very large role in the region. So in the GCC, they're all but non-existent. If you look across North Africa, I think it varies from country to country. The same is true in the Levant area. So to me, as an outsider, I don't see that big of a role for the labor unions in most of these countries, because the labor unions aren't that representative today of the population at large. Now, that may vary from country to country. And so, again, I don't know the specific example of Tunis, for example, and how prevalent or strong the unions are there. I don't have personal experience with that.
I think a big part of the story mm-hmm. is in implementation and in communication. So, I mean, there's a lot of collected best practice on how you design effective, means-tested social safety nets. And that's how, you know, subsidy reform needs to be designed and communicated. That it's not about the elimination of these subsidies, and it's especially not about eliminating them for the neediest. It's about restructuring them so that they are appropriate, means-tested social safety nets that are benefiting the poorest and the neediest. And I think that's an important part of what to bring to a conversation with labor organizations that are powerful in Tunisia, but to be able to communicate and articulate a plan that is about serving the needs of the most vulnerable within a constrained budget and within a planning process that seeks to take into account more equitable and inclusive development progress.
Thank you.
I'll address the question related to tourism. Tourism, according to our new constitution, is acknowledged as one of the major resources for the economy. So this is final. The good news that I'm having is that we are now regaining the number of tourists that we used to have in 2010, right before the revolution. Probably this year we'll see the same number, around 14 million tourists coming to Egypt. Of course, they are not generating the same level of income, and that is good news for the tourists because things are actually less expensive. That's why it's not generating the same level of income. It's not good news for us, but nevertheless, it is it's showing that tourists are regaining the level of confidence that led them choose and select to come to Egypt as a destination. The more important indicator is that actually tourists are spending more time in Egypt. Previously, the average tourist used to spend 7 or 8 days. We are seeing numbers around 12 days right now as an average number of nights per tourist spent in Egypt. This indicates many things. This indicates a level of confidence in the security of our country. This indicates the gradual diminishing of the concept, the misconception that people are having that a regime that is supported by the Muslim Brotherhood or by Islamists is against tourism. This is not the case. And they have, maybe that was some sort of a perception that was there right after the revolution. But right now, the proof is that we've been there for more than 2 years, and actually, when it comes to tourism, the situation is improving. So I absolutely agree with you, and we are actually, I refer to this particular point in answering one of the questions. considering tourism to be one of the key pillars for our development, and particularly for it is able to achieve a lot of quick wins very quickly in terms of generating income and generating a good pattern of development for Egypt.
Okay, anything on the NGO question?
Well, actually, I cannot add that I do understand the concerns and the negative feelings that the people in the United States or in Germany have about this verdict. This is absolutely understood. I am very sympathized with those who were convicted. But nevertheless, again, this is the result of a legal process. We as government, we do not have any means of interfering into that. And tell me anywhere in the world that the government can interfere and redirect a verdict.
Two points briefly, if I may. Nazanin mentioned the president's clemency power. Is that something that the government is discussing? In addition, I would note that the government's also proposed a law for judicial reform, arguing that this judiciary represents the old regime. So it's difficult simultaneously to argue that we have to let the judicial rulings stand without interference.
No, but until we have this law, as a matter of fact, we are being criticized for proposing this law.
Indeed.
For the judiciary. And as a matter of fact, the judiciary has been praised for making other verdicts, right? So this is a very delicate issue. And if you invite the president to use his powers for general pardon or things like that, this is something that has to be very well thought of and carefully designed, if you will. You know, what are the implications of such thing? What will be the perception of the people in Egypt about an action like this? Of course, it's very important to solve this problem. And I, from my position, I do assure the United States that we do care about having very good relationship with the United States. Our relationship with the U.S. is quite strategic. Sometimes there are problems that come between, you know, friendly countries, but nevertheless, we would like that this does not really negatively affect our cooperation, our long-term cooperation, our mutual interests. So we need to deal with this issue quite wisely, quite realistically, and calmly, without extensive pressures, because this is the right environment that will allow us really to handle this to the best way possible.
Thank you. Any parting words from either of the others on the panel, Nazanin?
Well, I'm going to respond one more time on this point, which is, I mean, just to say that indeed the U.S. and Germany, as the countries with organizations impacted in this trial, and the countries contending now with impacts on the bilateral relationship, have expressed concern about this outcome. But importantly, there has also been concern expressed from international organizations, other watchdog organizations across the board, because again, this verdict is not just about, although it is importantly about the impact on our relationship and the impact on US or German organizations, but it is also about what it says about rights of association and what it says about the space for civil society to operate in Egypt, what we see, and what we see that is squarely within the responsibility of this government is the changes that have come into play between what was articulated in the Constitution, which was broad freedoms for civil society to associate. What was articulated in the original law put forward by the Freedom and Justice Party, which again affirmed the original platform of greater freedom for Egyptians, to what's been articulated now. And that is something that is squarely in the hands of this government, and as I said, is a huge opportunity to affirm your original support for civil society and the freedom to operate.
Well, the law is not final, and there is still a big room to look at it and see what can be done.
Okay, room for dialogue. Ladies and gentlemen, we're going to have to leave it there. Your lunch is waiting for you downstairs. Let me make a couple of housekeeping notes, if I may. After lunch, At 2:15, your working groups resume in the same rooms that they've been in, and you'll be there until 4:30. And then you have a break in the afternoon, but I must ask you, please be downstairs in the lobby by 6:45 so that we can board the buses for our dinner on the waterfront. So please be on time for that this evening at 6:45 in the lobby. And right now, would you please join me in thanking this fantastic panel for a wonderful discussion.